Here we go, round 11 underway here at Brands Hatch. It's a great start then from what is Gunnar Nienhuis.
Godinho having maybe a look to the next very fast right, and then they're going to be side by side through turn 6, and Mitten's run wide, and Karen Owen's going to go straight through the middle of them.
Mitten, there's a little bit of a wiggle and a bit of contact, and he's going to turn himself around.
Oh, and speaking of mistakes, there is Lorenzo Wright going out.
Lorenzo Wright, they see, stranded on the curb.
Oh, and Liam Robbins, no, he's going to lose it on the break in there.
If you look at your race leader, Gunnar Nienhuis jumping away now. One corner side by side, two corners side by side. It's going to be a great move, and he does hold it around the outside. One of the great moves in AOR. He running off cam, ties on the grass, and his championship turns off. I think that's the end of Michael Mitner. Nienhuis will come to the line and take the win. Bajon, Francois Gaudin, who comes across the line and becomes the fourth different AOR world champion. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the AOR Formula Renault 2.0 Championship, Season 1, Round 12, your season finale here. From Autodromo José Carlos Pathé, otherwise known as Interlagos, of course, championship already decided. Jean-Francois Gaudin is your driver's champion. Jake Sparey, joined by everyone's favourite commentator, it's Fizzy.
Yes, thanks, Jake. Very, very excited for this race. Interlagos, one of my favourite racing circuits, and also, even though the driver championship is decided for the title, a very close championship fight for second still, with the five drivers involved, and also the team championship is wide open at the top.
Yes, most certainly. You can see five drivers split then by what is just 11 points at the moment. That's going to be very interesting to look at. Of course, it's 36 laps, 15 turns, 4.3 kilometers of Brazilian asphalt, and one mandatory pit stop required. Certainly going to be interesting today. So let's take us through now to the qualifying results. A very, very close qualifying indeed then from Interlagos. Kerry Nolden then, the godfather, gets a qualifying pole with a 130.419. He only just edges out Christian Koch by 0.03 of a second. Michael Mitner will qualify in the second row. He's joined alongside by Christian Takash, of course, another title contender. Patrick Kessler there, the Swiss superstar. Fantastic qualifying for him. He's on row number three with another driver with a fantastic qualifying for his team. And that's Frederik Johansson of the Team Tortoise car. Andy Cowie and Gunnar Nienhuis on row four. Surprising to see Gunnar Nienhuis so far down the order. René Osterkamp in ninth. And Knut Martinsen will round out the top 10, just 0.4 off the pace. There you can see on the second page, the top 19 split by 0.8 of a second. Leon Robinson then for Robinson Racing, his last outing in this venture. He will be alongside Jannik Nienhuis, second of the Carbon Racing cars. Ty McLeod and Evan Imray, they lock out row number 7. Row 8 sees a very experienced row 8 with Robert Plumley and also Christoph Leister, the Austrian. The long-lost cousin of Manuel Neuer. It's Manuel Hoyer there in 17th, joined alongside by the drum team's Bruno Dometer there in 18th. Lorenzo Wright there for Rich Racing is in 19th. He's joined alongside by the very experienced Steve Kager in 20th. And looking back then onto what is your final page here. Just 28 drivers then on this final grid there. You can see Luke White there in 21st, joined alongside by Vittorio Salamacchia. Lionel Alberto there with Chris Robinson, lockout row 12. Nigel Spears and Senna Kokan there. Phil Reed has messed up his qualifying. He has to start from the final row of the grid, but he does have a fellow friend alongside him, and that is Jamie Colden. Welcome to the grid then, ladies and gentlemen. There you can see just how difficult this grid is. Of course, it slopes uphill, so for the cars who are back there in 10th or 12th, they got a downhill run. It's very, very interesting to see. Of course, Nolden on pole position at number 35, Aperture Motorsports car. You can see lights on top of your iRacing gantry. Green flag underway here for the final time this season, and already you can see Kerry Nolden hard to the inside, looking to defend from Christian Koch as they head to the center S for the very first time. And there you can see round the outside trying to go inside line for turn number 2. Christian Koch hasn't got it sorted yet though, round the curve of the Sol, hasn't got it all sorted, but now Michael Mittner looking to get himself in through for the LMRN Sport outlet. And you can see, threads the needle, looks for the lead. Already you can see, fantastic battling, but Nolan on the inside, on the brakes. And well, oh, it's a massive wiggle as well. And Koch at the Deschino de Largo will get himself through. And now to Cash, up into a podium position. Already fantastic stuff, Fizzy.
Yeah, a lot of action so far in this race. Koch making the breakthrough in the end to take the lead after some great battling and this side-by-sides everywhere in the midfield as they now narrowed out into one line, mostly through this tricky uphill section. Oh, a little bit under pressure there. Fredrik Johansson defending from Granina, so it's made up two positions since the start. But yeah, I think it's pretty much all clean so far this race, which is very good to see.
Into the Bico de Pato they go into right now, the Ducks Bill, as they head themselves now in towards this lovely sweeping left-hander, completely on the power. And then you head to Jun Shao here, the junction corner. One of the favourite corners then in the legendary Justin Sutton's commentary career. But now, big, big wiggle there for Janik Nienhuis. There's contact. Ty McLeod turns himself around, buys himself all on the grass, trying to turn it around. Doesn't work out, but on this first lap you can see, Fizzy, already you can see the battle starting to take effect.
It really does, because Christian Koch now has to defend the lead from Kerry Nolan, who will be taking the outside line after Koch claims that inside. Can he hold it around to the outside? It's very, very tricky. Cambered to the inside and Koch manages to hold onto that one. Mittner also having to give way for the catch, who moves himself up to third place. So it's looking good for the top four at the moment. Gunnar Nina is also surely wanting to get involved. And now his brother, Yannick, he spins off on the exit of turn two, and that is going to be, well, Ray certainly very much compromised it for his part.
Deschino de Largo then, they come along. Christian Takash then in a very good position. He's up in the top three. And if he passes Kerry Nolan, he might be in a position to take second in the Drivers' Championship right now into what is this lovely, lovely right-hander of Ferradura right now. And you can see there back from Yannick's incident there. Just lost it there on the exit. And now into this lovely right-hander. And now the Pinarino coming up next. Leanne Robinson we're looking at here. And well, they're going to get very close, but not quite close enough here. Trying to go around the outside is Martinsen then. And of course, the news in, there's going to be future teammates. But look at Phil Reed's start here, Fizzy. He's gone to 15th. From what is 26th in the space of one lap. Fantastic work, running outside at the Bico de Pato.
I don't even know how many times we've said this season. You know, Phil Reed storming through the field from the back after messing up qualifying. It seems to be happening more times than not this season, to be honest. And once again, it just shows that he clearly is a lot better in the race than qualifying at the moment. But looking back now towards the front of the field, the Cash, I feel like he may be defending a little bit because he is slowing down and Mittner goes straight through. He's clearly not wanting to defend that very hard at all, as Martinsen actually under pressure from Evan Imrain to turn one, as Christian Koch out in the lead, setting the fastest lap of the race and looking very good at the moment.
130.994 then, fantastic work from him. Looking at Robert Plumley right now in P number 15, so he's got himself back past then Phil Reed, so he's got to do all that work again now, looking for an opportunity to get past the Leistermeister, Christoph Leister, and can he get it through? Well, you're going to see, they're going to go side by side. It might just have to be a very bold move down to the inside. He goes along and Reed's going to try and follow through. He gets one and he might just get two at an Esquina de Largo. Reed is on a rampage there. That's not a Phil Reed special. That is a Phil Reed masterclass.
Yeah, he's finding new ways to pass people, and certainly, I mean, he's made so many passes in this race already and showing everyone how it's done. The racecraft, certainly nothing to complain about for Phil Reed, and a little bit of a breathing space for him in terms of overtakes for now, though. There was a space ahead of him now, but Ostergamp, not too much space for him, as he's side by side is that with Patrick Kessler, I believe, moving him down to 8th place, René Ostergamp up to 7th, and now we'll be hoping to chase down the top 6, who have had a slight breakaway out in front.
Yes, he's made the move forward then into P number 7. That was the move over on Patrick Kessler, the Swiss superstar, who has really fallen down the field. He's minus 3 at the moment, but you can see this beautiful train then of what is 5 cars up at the front then. Koch, Nolden, Mittner, Takash, Nienhuis, but side by side they go down the front straightaway, down the hill, up the hill, and now you can see Andy Cowie looking at a way back then on what is René Ostergamp. Nienhuis 130.6, but look at this, Liam Robinson gets it wrong, and tap and turn around, he collects Leister alongside, and that has not worked out then for what is the car of Liam Robinson, as Nienhuis now looks side by side for the Deschino de Largo.
And once again, Christian Takash deciding not to fight hard at all. clearly he might be playing the long game in terms of not fighting too hard. He wants to just make sure that he stays with this train and builds that gap up to the following cars, so that you know, when they do want to start battling hard later in the race, you know, they have enough of a gap to the following cars to not drop further back down the field. But yeah, for Liam Robinson's case, that contact, he will be very, very lucky if he gets away from that without any sort of damage. Obviously, with these cars, it's a little bit inconsistent in terms of the touches, whether you get severe damage or not. But, you know, sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Hopefully for him, he did not get too much air.
Here, looking at Robert Plumley now in P13 on circuit, looking for an opportunity then to get himself through on Phil Reed. He stayed very, very close then to the back of the Aperture Motorsports car. Of course, if Phil Reed could get a portal up to carry on, he'll be very, very happy with that. And well, you can see the 147 on the brakes down to Jun Shao. But we're going to look at Michael Mittner here once again. Lap 4 here of 36, now going on to lap number 5. You can see he's in the toe, looking for an opportunity to get through on one of the very, very best. Hard to the inside, he'll have to go. Nolden couldn't defend any further. And on the brakes, into the centre S. And Nolden has to yield. He's dropped the position there, Fizzy. He's down into what is P3 for the time being.
Yeah, you can really see that he wanted to defend the inside there, but he just didn't do it aggressively enough into turn one. Mittner had a tiny, tiny gap that he went through, and this time he is going to have to defend the inside with Nolden on the outside through turn number 4. Are they going to make it through there alive? They are indeed. Nolden backs out of it in the end, avoiding that contact. But while these guys are battling, and Nienau's getting involved actually, he's going to take advantage, pretty similar to what Phil Reed did further down the field earlier. But Nienau's having the inside line for this uphill right, and Nolden falls very wide, dropping another position.
Yeah, carrying on now in a little bit of trouble right now, and Gunnar Nienhaus really showing what he's made of. He's plus 5, I believe, at the moment here, as we look at Christian Koch's perspective right now. He is out and away, and I think he's just broken 1 second. And if he has done that, Fizzy, you do have to say that Mittner, Nienhaus, and Nolden are going to have a very long day at the office.
Yeah, that of course. It's within about 8 tenths or so where you get the proper slipstream effect in this car, so dropping further out than that can be pretty... that's a big deal for Koch in terms of him retaining this lead now, because Mittner has to work so much harder to try and close that gap up to the first position.
Yes, most certainly. Of course, this is not just a driver's battle. This is a team's battle. An Aperture locked in conflict then with LM Rennsport and also the cars of Zephyr Racing as well. To the outside goes Kerry Nolden. No, won't happen at the centre S. Looks at it for the second part. No, we'll have to do it then in through the Deschiedi de Largo turns 4 and 5. But what has to be noted is only one member here for what is Zephyr Racing. And well, actually, we're going to see Bruno Domser off the circuit at the moment then. But to go back to my point, there as the North Atlantic goes off as well, 3 wide. Oh, I can't even get my point across because they're battling so hard. But we do have to say that with only one member, Fizzy, it's going to be so, so difficult to score the points needed.
Yeah, and Zephyr, obviously, they need to close an 8-point gap up to LM Rennsport at the moment. They have 6 points in hand on the Aperture. It's super, super close, only 14. Oh, actually, that is some drama. Mittner spinning and Mittner with Nienhaus and Nolden, Jake. This is all kicking off now.
It's all kicked off and they've all gone round. And what this will do, though, is just bunch everyone up then. They can see Osterkamp there. They can see the car there of what it's going to be. Fredrik Johansson, he's losing the car around. Into the wall goes Johansson. Into the wall goes Nienhaus. His car was buckled, his car was bent, and now you can see the damage that's done. The field completely slowed, and that contact, it has all hurt everyone. Look at the rear wing on Michael Mittner's car. He is really going to be struggling with top speed now here, Fizzy.
Yeah, huge controversy then on lap number 6. Mittner obviously losing it by himself under braking, presumably locked the rear tyres, is what it looked like. And Nienhaus not really having anywhere to go. It was too close behind to really avoid it. Made contact with that rear wing. Unfortunately, that clearly gave him too much damage to control the car as he then spun in front of Johansson, who was just another unlucky victim of that one. And Mittner carrying on, but a very, very damaged rear wing.
All 4 of these drivers then have the potential to be second at the moment. And what has to be said is Nienhaus had an opportunity, and now Nienhaus is out. And that just epitomizes a season of ill misfortune there. It wasn't his fault. He went for a move, or someone went for a move on him. He took the tap, and in the end, they all took each other out. Skittles, 6s and 7s. And now you can see the run for Ferradura. René Osterkamp now in the prime position to take Michael Mittner's battered and bruised LM Rennsport car as we look at Martinsen and Reed.
Yeah, and they're going to go side by side up through the double right-hander. Martinsen leaving the room there for Reed, who's continuing his comeback drop. He's up Now that'll be 20 positions, I believe, since the start of the race. Obviously, he's qualified 27th after not getting a proper lap in, and now he's all the way up in 7th position, taking advantage of the cars that obviously now is out of the race as well, which certainly helps. So we're now looking back at Andy Cowie, who is also not having a particularly great race. He was leading the championship at one point, remember. I believe was it after Monza, round 4, that he was leading? I feel like he was. But hasn't had all his way since then, and now struggling a little bit in this race as well.
Yeah, certainly is. And well, you have to say, Andy Cowie now looking at the back of Robert Plumley and Evan Imray. This is a midfield scrap, and he doesn't want to be in that. And of course, two very experienced drivers up ahead of him. But well, we are going to look back at Christian Takash then. Here looking at René Osterkamp down in towards turn of one. You can see the locking of the tyres as they get themselves in. Of course, they don't want to scrub those too much. If they do, they're going to start losing wear, start losing performance. Rani outside tries to go Andy Cowie on Evan Imray, the Scotsman. No, not going to happen. Going to have to wait just for the time being in that triple two machine. Round the curve of the Sol and Fizzy. If he can get this one dialed in, he gets a great run. But you can see the slipstream train oh so important right now.
It really is. Slipstream has two major straights. This has been one of them where the slipstream is so good to have. But obviously, Johansson there. Not Johansson. Imray also not doing too well considering the car he was trying to overtake also had the slipstream ahead of him. But it's really close still for second place. And all this battling still is giving Christian Koch the chance to pull away because he just... He's kind of the only man who hasn't been caught up in some kind of battle or controversy since like lap 2. And he's really taking advantage of that as Osterkamp sticks his nose up the inside on Michael Mittner. Maybe feels that Mittner is slowing him down a little bit, and he certainly is now as he's put a wheel on the grass and lost the back end a little bit as well. Osterkamp cuts underneath to surely get that position up into the podium position now.
Yes, he had to lift out of the throttle there, and that's so, so important because that what this has done is meant that there is now a gap to the number 35 machine of Kerry Nolan, but Mittner is not over and done with it. You can see, tucked right underneath that gearbox, heads himself now through the final corner, now heads himself down towards what is the Senna S's right now. You can see here on the outside, Mittner trying to do the long game. Can he get it sorted? Well, at the moment, no, he does have the inside though for turn number 2, but he gets a massive slide on the curb, and he goes round in a very similar fashion to Jannik Nienhuis earlier on as he tries to rejoin.
Yeah, that is absolutely disastrous for the LM Rennsport team. I'm not completely sure on the marks there, but I think that's been might just have put their double score at the moment in a position where Aperture actually scores enough points to pass him in the championship. I'm not fully sure on that one, but it's very, very likely that they're now scoring 14 points more. We're going to have to keep an eye on how that develops, of course. But Mittner and Cowie not having their way at all in this final race. The cash, though, is now given an opportunity. He's kind of been taking it quite easy through all of this. Not made contact with anyone, just sitting there and still keeps himself in that fight for the podium. Although Nolan now seems to be pulling a little bit of a Koch just later on and pulling away in second place.
Yes, you've got to look a little bit further behind as well, because now you look at Patrick Kessler there in P5. He's got Phil Reed right behind him, but we're focusing on Takash Osterkamp here. This is the battle for the final spot on your podium at the moment. Lap 9 of 36. We are 1/4 of the way through the motor race right now. And remember, there is one mandatory pit stop required. Pit stop window, anything from around lap 13, we're thinking, to somewhere around lap number 26. That is very much potential to come in, but expect these guys to run a late to stop. Takash hard then, looking themselves through. Has to go to the outside there. Couldn't do anything better than that. But you can see, as they head themselves now in towards turn number 1, can he get a move sorted? No! Doesn't get it, but Osterkamp's going to turn around, though, on the brakes. And that's a real shame, because he dropped so much time. Reed through on Kessler, and now Reed, potentially, up into P4 from the back of the grid in the space here, Fizzy, of just 10 laps.
Yeah, mistakes galore at the moment. Osterkamp, another one then, to lose control under braking, locking those rears. And Reed goes straight through on him into turn 4. No problem at all there, given the bad exit that Osterkamp got, obviously. Kessler trying to get him involved as well. Martinsen just behind. Robert Plumley down in 8th, not too far behind. It's pretty closely contested still down in the midfield, even though he's spreading it out a little bit towards the front. So, well, so far it's been action-packed every single lap in this race, and it's not looking like stopping anytime soon.
Four-car train then behind Phil Reed. Reed, Osterkamp, Kessler, Martinsen right now. This is the battle from 4th all the way to 7th. And Phil Reed is certainly putting on a show right now. On the brakes into the Bico de Pato. Now you take this long left-hander, which is always trying to fall away from you. And now you can see from Martinsen's perspective here, he is right behind Patrick Kessler here, the Swiss superstar. very tight, closes up on the brakes then into the left-hander of Jun Xiao, and now he's just got to run these high left-handers, this top speed here, so crucial. But it's very difficult when you try and set up this car here, Fizzy, because you look at it on one hand, you've got this massive long straight that you need to be quick on. You look at it on the other hand, though, you've got a lovely tight infield section which you can be very, very, very quick on. It's very difficult how you set up your thing, as you're going to see side by side.
Yeah, it really is, because, as you said, it's two different sections of the track which are very, very, very different. You need a high top speed, of course, on this part, but then you also want a nice, stable, downforce car for the middle sector of the lap. But if you take too much downforce, you're going to be even slower on the straight. So it's a bit of a dilemma, and you have to compromise a lot, as they are still side by side in the battle for fifth. Kessler getting the upper hand. Osterkamp a little bit hard on the curb there, not getting the ideal exit, and Martinsen might actually come through to take advantage. And then Osterkamp actually, surprisingly, I must say, dropping like a stone at this moment in time.
Yeah, last season these two battled it out, and that was for the final spot on the podium. In the end, it would be Martinsen who would prevail, who would lose out in the end. It would be René Osterkamp who would win that battle and get a third place finish. But now you look at what Martinsen's doing now. He's up in a circuit which he really does like, and now he's up in P6 on the grid. Is the number 20 machine, the man with the most starts in AOR at the moment. And where you can see René Osterkamp really starting to struggle, and you can see actually behind, there is the car of Leanne Robinson trying to recover. He's got himself through on Imre, and now he looks at Robert Plumley.
Yeah, and now we look back at the leader. We can actually see how big of a gap. Will Karen Alton appear anytime soon in the background? There he is, I think. So, you can see there is about 5, 6, 7, 8 seconds. I'm not going to say a complete estimate there, but certainly a very comfortable gap at the moment, as Leanne Robinson does not go for a move on Robert Plumley. He lifts off the throttle there, and Plumley, though, is going to go for the move on Osterkamp, maybe dropping him even further down the field. This time, Robinson and Osterkamp both get it through turn one unscathed after making mistakes there earlier, but Plumley still very much piling that pressure on, and Osterkamp letting him go through on the inside. Robinson, though, getting super great run with a double slip there. And will he go through the middle into turn four? That'll be a very brave. No, it backs out and slots into Plumley's line. He is, though, going to take Osterkamp still. Very good driving for all these guys. And the battle rages on in the midfield.
As you see it on your screen here, look at the front right of René Osterkamp. The front wing is bent in. That is damage there on what is the Hydropulse racing machine. And actually, Kerry Nolden is going to do a trademark half spin, and he's going to lose some time. Well, you have to say, he's lost it there at the Pinarino, and now he drops it to his teammate, who now gets up onto the podium, and well, give that man a medal right now, because you had to say earlier in the broadcast, give him a portal and get him up to his teammate, Kerry Nolden. He's just done it.
He's created a very nice portal for himself, and his he's just blasted it to him. I mean, it's been a very characteristic race for both of those two in terms of their season overall. Phil Reed usually having storms from the back of the field. Kerry Nolden usually qualifying high up, but then having some mistakes in the race. And it's happened again for Kerry Nolden, down outside the podium positions now, and has it all to do to get back in, as Phil Reed even sets a new fastest lap. So he's really, really flying, as Plumley and Robinson this time, side by side into turn one, will... Can Plumley hold on from this one? Two very experienced drivers in this league, and Plumley does hold on. But Robinson now will get a nice slipstream run down towards turn four.
Yes, Liam Robinson then will try and utilize the slipstream here. Looking at Christoph Leister then in a scrap further down the field, and he's going to turn himself around down under the brakes as well. He was fighting with Chris Robinson, the other Robinson racing car. Imre, there you can see in ninth right now, there you could see Liam Robinson hasn't got himself through, but behind there is René Osterkamp, and he's under threat now from Andy Cowie in that 2.2 machine there also. So, Osterkamp falling down the field, Cowie going nowhere, Imre up in ninth position. Great result for him at the moment. We haven't really seen too many top tens from him far this season here, Fizzy, but, you know, the 999 in ninth position, very, very good work from him.
Really is, yeah. He's had two top 10 finishes this season, with ninth being his best result this time around. So yeah, he'll certainly be happy with his performance so far. Kind of stayed out of the trouble, showed solid pace as well in this final race, and looking good at the moment. He'll be just trying his best to hang on to the back of these guys, who will not be wanting to drop out of slipstream range, as that is so crucial for lap time as you go through this really, really long straight. The main straight, of course, as Robinson is going to try to utilize that straight now to maybe have a move on Plumley into turn one.
There you can see. Look how hard he goes in. Actually, Plumley's going to go pit lane bound. Early pit stop lap 14. The undercut coming into play for what is going to be Robert Plumley to cash. 134.90, fastest lap. He's trying to close down Christian Koch. But for the time being, you can see just how everyone's going to fight. Back of the grid fight then we're seeing here. This is for 16th, Kegra White. Saltala Macchio is there also? No, that's Chris Robinson then trying to go in this fight then. Round the outside will go Steve Kegra then. And that's a very, very comfortable move then on the Buzzing and Hornets there. B&H Robinson Racing branded car there, of course. And that's actually Luke White there in a Ferrari livery there, spinning around for MDAR Racing. That is the Curva de Sol. That is turn number three. And that epitomizes his season.
Yeah, he also got, was right behind Robinson and Kegra into turn one before he made a mistake, of course. As we're now looking at Saltala Macchio, who you mentioned, he is fighting with Leister for what is 17th place in the race. Obviously, points scored all the way down to 20th, so it's still things to play for. And of course, they're having fun out there, battling and trying to get all the positions that they possibly can. Saltala Macchio with a very good switchback move there to get the inside line for turn, is that 7, I believe, and he gets that position back. So his teammate, though, running a little bit further up the road in 15th, and actually slotted himself between Kegra and Robinson, so Kegra is made of him up some time. Oh, actually, oh, he just pitted, didn't he? So he must have come out in the middle of them. Not ideal for him, really.
Certainly not ideal for Robert Plumley there, as we look at Christian Tekash. He's going to get a massive twitch around, he goes! Anybody who is in that second position has had an incident, and now Tekash drops through the field. Reed was really putting him under pressure there. Another fastest lap of the race went purple once again. Hasn't worked. And actually, say that at the same time, Michael Minter turns around as well, and you could see the tyre dipped into the asphalt there. That was contact into the inside barrier as well. It's certainly not worked out. As you look at Robert Plumley trying to run the outside line, he's now finally cleared the traffic and now needs to get some clear air and some clean laps here, Fizzy.
Yeah, I mean, the poor race for Mittner continues, and I think it's almost a certainty now that with Reed and Nolan for Aperture in second and third place as it stands, and Mittner and Cowie way down the field at the moment, Aperture has taken the lead of the championship, despite Koch in first place doing his very best to save it for Zephyr, with only one driver scoring. That is looking very tricky for him. So, but of course, longer race to go. Something could still happen with Reed and Nolan to take the win for them again in this race. But as it stands, it's looking very good for the team championship.
Lap 15 at the moment of 36. Looking at Martinsen then, having a little scrap with Patrick Kessler for what is a career best fourth for Kessler. For the moment, Martinsen in P5. This could be his best result all year long. He hasn't had the season that he wanted to have. And now you could see this could be redemption here for Martinsen in the Force Fizzy machine into what is this final thing. And Kessler, oh, he duped him. Thought he was going to go into the pits. No, he's not. But now the inside isn't covered. And now into turn number one, Martinsen to the inside. And that is very much a piece of cake. That is a very, very good move then from the driver from Norway.
Yeah, a little bit scary with Kessler's line, almost playing a fake pit entry there. If Martins had followed that and not quite reacted in time, he would have maybe ended in the pit wall. Luckily, that didn't happen. And he still has to defend, though. Kessler's not giving up on this position. He wants, of course, to get as much as he can. I think that cockpit upgrade that he had, that you mentioned last time out, is really working for him. Of course, for a career best result in the league, as you say, and still not giving up. Martinsen going defensive now through this right-hand corner, but Kessler realizing it's hard, super hard to go around the outside there since it's such a long corner, so he has to back out of it for now, or maybe he'll be looking to get it back on the next main straight.
Into the Pinarino right now, you could see there just a bit of a slide coming in that's going to affect his top speed, and there's a bit of a smoky moment there for Vittorio Saltala Macchio there. I believe he's just gone sideways, and here comes Ty McLeod, who's looking to recover through the field side by side for Ferradura. Three wide for Ferradura, no way, no, we're going to say wait behind Andy Cowie. He just came into the box. And well, now he is right behind traffic and now needs to traverse it as quickly as he can. Can't do it at the moment. And you can see, still looking at it, Ty McLeod, he's just got a little bit of a gap here, Fizzy. But you have to remember here, Saltala Macchio now under threat. And now Andy Cowie must be desperate to get away through.
Yeah, of course, he will be feeling, I think, maybe has the pace on these guys. And of course, feeling the pressure of losing the team championship potentially as well. So he'll be wanting to just score as many points as possible in hope that it'll be enough, as McLeod is, he's had a poor all season really, with mistakes happening very frequently for him. And there's another one, luckily not as big as some of his others that he's had. Robinson though, fighting at the moment with Kessler, so Kasten's dropped back a little bit from Martinsen, and Robinson now putting him in under pressure, cutting back in front, just about very close to being contact there, but Robinson just about gets that move done from the outside. Very, very impressive.
Impressive move then from Leanne Robinson. He's chasing down a driver who will be his teammate for next season. Looking at Michael Mittner then as he heads through and round he goes again at an Esquina de Largo. And he plants himself there down on the inside. It has gone from bad to worse to really miserable for Michael Mittner. And now you can look at Andy Cowie there behind, having himself a little look at Talamakia. Can he get himself a way through? No, he's going to run wide a little bit as well. But cannot get the move sorted just yet. But you do have to remember here, as you might have a look into Ferradura on the outside. Oh, it was so close. There, we almost saw a moment there of pure madness, but it hasn't paid off. But what has to be remembered here is that we've had a couple of incidents left, a couple of incidents right. You just got to be careful, especially for your Michael Mittner here, as we look at Steve Kager going incredibly wide.
Yeah, and it's worth actually pointing out that a little bit of a heartbreak for a few of these guys who have had overall very, very strong season. You look at Gunnar Nienhaus, obviously, out of the race already. Mittner really, really struggling out right now. And Osterkamp, I believe he actually has retired from the race as well. Those three going into this race, second down to fourth in the championship. And Mittner's going to lose it all now. He's hit the wall very, very hard. That surely is finally the race fully over for him. So second to fourth, all those three drivers in the championship has retired. Nolan to Cash, looking like the drivers to take advantage.
Yes, certainly will be. And now we're looking at the driver in the final points playing position. Will go up one more position with the incident with Michael Mittner. That is Loren de Rijk in the 034 at the moment then, as we look at Christian Koch going through. But the point I was trying to make but didn't quite get to is that Martinsen and Robinson, this battle, of course, they're going to be teammates for next season. And it's going to be so interesting to see which one gets ahead of the other, which one here, Fizzy, decide they are the quicker driver.
Yeah, it's an interesting dynamic, of course. You kind of want to go into the next season with a bit more confidence than your new teammates and feel like you have the upper hand. Obviously, they've been very close to contestants all season long, so I'm really looking forward to next season, how they kind of match up and who claims the role as the number one driver as the season progresses. It'll really be interesting, but I guess, in a way, it starts here today as they're both now in the fight for the podium.
If you look on your left-hand side, you can see that graphic. Phil Reed has already come in for the stop. So has, I believe, Christian Takash as well. So looking at your race leader, Christian Koch. And, well, we're going to look back to Kerry Nolden then, who is still yet to make a pit stop. Still looking for an opportunity to get himself back onto the back of the Austrian. But that gap is just getting wider and wider and wider still. And Kerry Nolden can't do anything. There's Martinsen in third, Robinson fourth, Kessler chasing behind in fifth. But we're going to look at Luke White here, who is trying to make a recovery. Round he goes again, and it's so, so atypical of what we've seen. Gets himself on the inside, though. Avoids all traffic there. Great awareness from the driver as we look at Patrick Kessler up the hill now, Fizzy. And he's just seeing these guys go away, and it must be so demoralizing.
Yeah, he wasn't quite close enough either to get that slipstream run on Robinson ahead of him. So that'll be quite frustrating for him after having fought those two both very hard earlier in the race. Here we're looking at Phil Reed, who's already pitted, whereas all the top five ahead of him have not. So it'll be interesting to see where he comes out. You'd expect him to be in second still after the stops are taken out, because that's where he was. And speaking of stops, here is his teammate, Kerry Nolden, into the pits, stopping on the box and actually being lifted up there, which is surprising. That's not something we normally see. And I feel like, actually, he's getting a much longer stop there than he would have wanted.
Yeah, I think he's going to change that front wing then. There you can see the front wing has been changed, gets himself out of the way, and that's going to cost him valuable seconds of time. And there you can see where he's going to come out. I saw a little bit of purple. I saw a little bit of Kinducci then as he heads himself now out of pit lane. And he must be very frustrated about that. He didn't seem to have too much of a pace drop, but now you can see Dometer coming out of pit lane. They can see two cars there alongside to get themselves out side by side just ahead of them. And, well, there you can see. And actually, he does cut the line a little bit on pit exit. I don't know whether there's going to be a little bit of a talk from the stewards afterwards about that, because he should have stayed over there, Fizzy, on the left-hand side.
Yeah, we'll see whether they feel like that was enough to be called in for a stop and go or something like that. But for now, he's carrying on, of course. And it was seen at Kokan, I believe, who was a lapped car that made it look very exciting with the side-by-side there, but he was actually being lapped. So Dometer just will be hoping that he gets away with that one. Robinson, though, and Martinsen both into the podium positions now, but of course have not pitted yet. And I feel like Robinson, yes, indeed, he does go in now. So as it's all a little bit muddled up as the pit stops are shaking out. And Jake has another spin for that man, Kerry Nolden.
And now he drops himself now further down. And now we said he was a little bit frustrated that he got that pit stop. He was a bit frustrated they changed the front wing. That was a team decision. But now Kerry Nolden, he's gone and made a mistake, a second one. Out comes Liam Robson, the man with the infinite fuel tank. But it just seems for the moment that he's been outdone by two guys on fuel tank. He's now in fourth. And now he's going to see exactly where cars are going to come out. Here comes Christian Takash. Here comes Patrick Kessler out of pit lane. And now you can see just how they're going to push. Kessler's been jumped.
Yes, indeed, yeah. He's not had the best... He's lost a lot of time on Robinson as well. He was definitely closer than that before. So Takash has slotted himself nicely in between. Plumlee also not too far behind. And now, of course, there's Imre. Where is Kerry Nolden? He'll be even further behind than that. So he's dropped two positions from that spin he had. And there he is. So down in ninth position. It's not too many laps ago that he was in second. He's had two mistakes since then. He'll be so frustrated with himself. At least for him, though, he's still got 13 laps of action this season to try and recover something from this race.
Yeah, most certainly. And well, we're looking at Jannik Nienhuis now of Garmin Racing. Nope, we're going to switch back. Chris Robinson, Robinson Racing then. Here, as he looks to see, there's a car just ahead of him just coming out of pit lane. That is Christoph Leister, if I am correct there, the Leister Meister. And where you can see, that's a battle for lower points. But for these guys fighting for lower points, Fizzy, it's so, so crucial. As your race leader here has just come in. When will he come out? Answer is now. Will he take the cone? No. But he will take himself and re-inherit the race lead.
He will indeed, yeah. And of course, as we mentioned before, points scored all the way down to 20th place. And some of these drivers fighting for the lower points will be in very tight battles further down the championship. So any sort of point score for them can be a matter of one or two positions in the championship. And actually, Christian Koch is still in the lead despite having pitted. But he's got Knut Martinsen all over the back of him, who is still to make his stop, of course. But I don't know, maybe that'll actually... Either it'll help or hurt Martinsen, depending on whether he actually is going to get held up here.
Yeah, most certainly you can see around the outside of Ferradura. It's brave, it's bold, it's not enough, though, as he heads himself now into what is this right-hander there. So difficult, you try and get yourself up and over the curb there. Not in the modified curb, not the modified asphalt either that we've seen relayed here around Interlagos in the previous couple of years. But Martinsen now heads himself into the Bico de Pato for the time being. Nope, not quite close enough, but he is on the back of Koch. And what that does mean is he can use the slipstream and he can get a little bit of a boost from the race leader here. You can see they run all over that... I don't know how really to call it. It's the same sort of thing that you see outside of Graham Hill Bend over at Brands Hatch there. It's that covering there. You can run it. It doesn't mean that you get an off track, but what it does mean is you really open the corner at Junshao.
Yeah, definitely. So let's see now. It's actually, I think this slipstream is really benefiting Martinsen actually now on his in-lap. He slows down for the pit lane. Slows down before the yellow cones to not get a speeding penalty, of course. I feel like he might have been held up slightly when he got very, very close through turns 6 and 7, but then might have just gained that time back by having to slipstream down the straight into the pit lane. So this is a man he'll be looking to get out ahead of. Of course, he was very close ahead of Liam Robinson, and the Cash, you can see, is really closing as well. Kessler still at some distance behind. So it'll be very interesting to see now how they all shake out when Martinsen comes out.
Here we go then. Let's see then on what is your right-hand side looking on board then with Red Devolutions. Christian Takash into the left-hander of the Curva de Sol. And there you can see on the outside on pit exit there. There you can see one car. That's Lorenzo Riker lap down. And there is Martinsen, who is now ahead still of Lee N. Robinson. So that has paid off in the end. But you can see, oh, they get so close. They almost touch it. In fact, they do, because Lorenzo Wright goes round. And that was just a case of miscommunication. Two into one there, Fizzy. It never goes.
Yeah, I think the Reich must have just been sleeping a little bit there. I mean, maybe didn't realize Takash was as close as he really was, because there was no way for him as a left car to really get in the way of him on the apex of the corner. But we can only hope that Takash got away with that without any sort of damage to his car. As we are now on to lap 27, with Nolden clearly pushing hard in down in 8th place now, setting the fastest lap, but there's still a lot of work to do.
A lot of work to do. Christian Koch then into turn number 1 on circuit then. And well, for the moment, he just seems to be in a world of his own. Phil Reed, P2 for the number 1. And well, he is one of these drivers then who has been trying to defend the title, could not get a win for the title last time out at Brands Hatch. But what does have to be said is this is a very valiant effort. This is a champion's effort from him, as we look at Robert Plumlee all over the back of Kessler here in the fight for 6th. To the inside goes the 147 machine, and the Kinducci man will put himself up into 6th position, which you could say last season would have been tied for his best ever finish, but Kessler's coming back.
He really is, and gets a massive slipstream run. Plumley low, showing his intentions very early, taking that inside line for turn number four. Will Kessler be daring and try to be late on the brakes? Now he's going to try and cut back for the cutback, but he has to back out of it because he turned in a little bit too early there. And we have a battle on for third position. Martinsen desperately trying to defend, with Robinson going around the outside of turn six and seven. Long way around, as we mentioned before, and still not enough for him. Will he cut back on the inside to have a move of the inside of the next corner? No, he will not. Martinsen is just taking a slight wide line just in case, but Robinson has to find another way through.
9 laps to go then in your motor race. Into the Bico de Pato comes Lee N. Robinson. He gets a very good run compared to Martinsen. Now looking to open up the inside then, trying to get a move possibly into Jun Shao. Will he get the move sorted? No. We'll wait behind here and use slipstream up the hill. Double whammy then. As you can see, moves already to the inside. And you can see more miles being used then from Martinsen on the outside line. We'll lose the time. We'll possibly lose the position here. Side by side. Down your front straight away. And well, I think Lee N. Robinson might have this. There is potential to hold it around the outside. Cut back to the inside, trying to dupe him there. Very much shaped to Montoya and Raikkonen. And now you can see to the inside, and through goes the car of what is Knut Martinsen back into the podium. Great scrap going on, Fizzy.
Yeah, really, really enjoying this one between the two teammates for next season, of course. It's such an amazing spectacle to see what is going on in the battle for podium, because both of them, of course, have not had a podium this season and for a long time. So I really, really will be wanting this, both of them. And the catch, of course, behind, will be hoping that they keep battling like this so that he can really close up that gap. And Martin's still going to try and defend. Robinson forced to go around the outside again. Last time it didn't work out. This time it just about doesn't work out. And this battle surely will go all the way till the end.
Well, that is barring any incident between the two, and neither of them want to take each other out, of course. They don't want any bad blood going into the new season, the new team. Of course, Leon Robinson leaving Robinson Racing, heading to Force Fiji. Massive twitch there on exit. That's going to compromise the run through this lovely sweeping left-hander, heading to Jun Shao there, the junction known as the left-hander there in Portuguese. But for the time being, you can see the gap there starting to just open up a little bit. You can't really see in the same shot Kessler and Plumley. I think Plumley's had a little bit of an incident somewhere because he has dropped a lot of time. But there you can see there the car of Christian Takash just waiting patiently on the back. Doesn't have to make the move, but down his front straightaway. Here we can see, is the move going to happen? To the outside goes the car of Leon Robinson. Will he get a move sorted this time around the outside? Well, we're going to see if he can hold it. No, doesn't happen.
And the battle continues then. Martinsen somehow still holding on. You can see Robinson really showing a great pace at the moment. He's forcing the Force Fiji car to defend at every single opportunity. Here we go again. He's going defensive into turn number four. And it remains to be seen what tactic Robinson chooses. He goes for the outside tactic rather than the cutback tactic on this occasion. And that might just be a great move for him, because that, for the first time in this battle, means that he'll claim the inside line for turn six and seven. It's not worked out for Robinson to be in the outside there. Will it work out for Martinsen? No, it will not. Robinson takes the third place in the race.
Yes, he does. But look at where Takash is right now. All over the back of this one as well. Into then, what is the Pinarino? 1, 2, 3, line A stern. This is the battle for third, fourth and fifth here on circuit then. Leon Robinson, Knut Martinsen and Christian Takash. Two Norwegians and a Brit walk into a bar. Well, you know what happens next then. In towards then the left-hand as they come along. And it's Jun Shao next. Is there going to be any sort of setup? And Fizzy, what has to be said here is Takash is in the prime position, but doesn't get a good enough run.
He doesn't. You may be very, very eager to know what happens if a Brit and a Norwegian walks into a bar. You can tell me about that later. But for now, we're the other way around. Even two Norwegians and a Brit who is leading that train, and Takash getting the slipstream, but Martinsen also having the slipstream for Robinson, and really working out to defend. And there's going to be no overtakes into turn one on this occasion for the first time in a while, it feels like. Although we are going to have one further back. Kessler dropping another position. Plumley moving himself up to sixth place. Another very strong race for him. He's had a few of those this season. Robert Plumley really showing himself as a good driver in this car. And once again, we've got side by side there. Martinsen on the inside into turn four, Jake, on Robinson. And can he take it this time?
He does for the moment. Kerry Nolden, fastest lap, 130.3. And now you're going to see here. Now you're going to see the guys trying to go back. And now Takash wants a piece of the action to the inside. Round the outside, looks. Leanne Robinson trying to take a page out of Phil Reed's book. But no, the book's not sourced. Still looks around the outside then. Down into this lovely right-hander. No, trying to get the cut back. Trying to just get a better exit where and as he can. But no, not happening here. Red Devolution's Christian Takash waiting very patiently here for an opportunity for a move through. But it's not working out for him. It's not working out for the Norwegian. And now it's a Norway sandwich.
It's not working out for the catch. But what we can say about him on a positive note is that actually, because of Nien House, Mittner and Ossekamp's problems, with this result, and Nolan's problems, of course, down in 8th position, with this result, Takash actually moves himself into 2nd place in the championship, from 6th going into the race. So even though he will certainly be hoping for a podium to finish this race off, he will be happy with his final position in the championship as it stands. And Phil Reed up in 2nd place, new fastest lap, he's clearly pushing Takash Koch, although I think the gap is a little bit too big.
It was 11 seconds before it came to pit lane. Actually, look how wide Leanne Robinson's gone. He completely severs that line. He completely gets himself all shades of wrong. And here comes Takash then, looking here to the outside at the Skeeter Largo. He's got the slipstream ahead of him from what is Knut Martinsen. Will he get it around the outside? No. He will not get it around the outside then with just 5 to go. He cannot get the moves sorted. Still has one more opportunity though. He's got himself to have to do it around the outside there. Great wide line taken there from Leanne Robinson through the second part of the Skidelago into Ferradura. And I don't think he can get it, no. Still can't get the opportunity here. Takash is setting up, not working. And look at where Nolan is.
Yeah, and he's right at the back of Kessler and Plumlee. So he'll be certainly looking for another couple of positions maybe before the end of this race. He'll be disappointed with his overall result because of where he was. He was in second very comfortably. He was challenging for the lead, of course, at the start of the race as well. But all he can do now is to try and get as much as he can. Kessler running wide out of the hairpin there. Nolan getting a much better run, but as we've seen many times, he'll probably wait until the main straight to make the move, because that's a much better opportunity. That'll also cost him less time while he blasts past, maybe now with the slipstream.
Well, he can see he's staying out of the slipstream just for the moment. Now he tries to tuck back in, half a wing there underneath that slipstream line. Now he's got to do it a long way around. Now he's got to do it around the outside of the Swiss superstar. Godfather versus superstar here. Well, it sounds like a premise for a TV show. Here we go, into turn number one, into the center S, and that one's very, very comfortable there for the Godfather, Kerry Nolan. He gets himself up into P number 7, but next is the hard-fighting Robert Plumlee, who will take every position as if it was his life. But now we look at Takash here into the left-hander of the Skeeter Largo. No, not quite close enough.
Not close enough. Here is Evan Emery, who is suddenly finding himself very lonely on track after being right in the mix earlier on. But still, a very solid result. Top 10 for him, only for the third time this season. So he'll probably be pretty satisfied with that one, as we are now back with the battle for a third. Although with the catch really challenging Robinson hard right now, we got to feel like these guys are causing each other time at the moment. To Martinsen, who has got a few tenths of a gap now on Robinson. So it remains to be seen whether Takash will keep that up and keep forcing Robinson to defend, or whether he'll let Robinson try to close the gap before he goes back at it.
Into the barrier challenge then, you could call this. Just stay behind him, make sure you get enough pressure there. And there's the mistake. There it was, 2 bites at a cherry to get through Jun Shao. And now Leanne Robinson has to wait behind, has to get back in that slipstream there. Takash is through with 3 to go when they cross the line. That is so, so crucial as things stand at the moment. There you can see how your field looks on your left-hand side. If we haven't mentioned anyone that you really do like, we do apologise there. But you can see now into turn number 1, Takash going defensive, Robinson around the outside. And well, he's got the inside then for the second part, gets it back. And Christian Takash is doing everything. And now Nolan hounding the back of Robert Plumlee, the very old veteran. And now the veteran against the Godfather. This is another great battle, you can see. And they're going to be there running it already, hard to the left-hand side, busy, as they head for the Skeeter Largo.
As hard as he possibly can. Plumlee is going to give Nolan absolutely a very, very hard time to get through here. And he does hold on to that position for now. 2 fantastic battles that's going to last until the end of the race, hopefully, with Takash versus Robinson for fourth, and then Nolan trying to get past Plumlee for sixth. We've yet to see a move today, I feel like, where someone's actually managed to hold it around the outside of those two particular corners. Nolan is still not able to do that. Plumlee now going defensive as much as he can on every single corner. This may gonna make Nolden have to go around the outside if he wants to get his move done.
He's got to make his car seem incredibly wide. It's got to be twice as wide as Nolden's if he wants to keep that position then. And it's two laps to go when they cross the line. The leader's already crossed the line. And now you can see a look at Jun Shao. And already you can see that gap opened up all over that curb there. That might be the mistake that cost him then. As you can see here underneath the slipstream then. And heading up now through the series of left-handers. They can see the favela there of Sao Paulo to the outside. We'll have to go Kerry Nolden on the Kinducci racing car of Robert Plumley. This is what metal is made of. Down towards the inside then of turn number one, the center S. There you can see on the right hand side, that's probably Rubens Barrichello's great uncle's house. And now you can see then down into the right hand and then turn number two. No, not going to happen for the time being.
It is not. Oh, and both Robinson and Takash live on the grass there as they start the run down to turn four for the penultimate time in this race. Takash breaking later. Can Robinson come back with this one? He will try. He gets a tighter line, but they're going to be side by side. And this time, Takash with the ideal line through six and seven coming up. Can he make it stick on this particular occasion? Or can Robinson be the first one to manage to haul it around the outside here? He's certainly trying. They're going to be so close at the top of this hill. But Takash has the inside line. And doesn't get the move. Robinson tries around the outside. But yes, Takash finally gets fourth for now. But there's still a lap to go for things to change once again.
Car off then, and that's a bat marker. But we're looking here at Christian Koch then. And that's so, so cruel. We've got two great battles. He now starts the final lap. And this could be his maiden race win. There is Phil Reed, and what an effort he has put in. What a stint, back of the grid to second. If there was ever a more worthy driver of the day candidate, there is. Looking now at his teammate, Kerry Nolden then. This is his last opportunity then. He's got to get the run sorted, and he's a little bit further back than what he was last lap. And now that might just cost him a little bit. Behind him is Kessler and Cowie if things go wrong. So you have to look then. Robinson looking for an opportunity. Inside line, final lap. And can he get a move sorted? He was tough on the brakes. Inside line though has given themselves to what is Christian Takash. But he still has the inside for the curve and a soul. And now he gets the move sorted. But now you see tucked back into slipstream. Takash desperate for the move. He doesn't have to make it. He's thinking about second in the championship. But no, he wants fourth to the inside and to the skin of the Largo. And they're going to remain side by side, are they? Yes, they are. As they head themselves now up towards Ferradura. Inside line given then to what is Leon Robinson. And Robinson Racing could have their best result of the afternoon, of the season. Has the inside line, tries to run in wide. And at the moment, just has the position for the time being. What a scrap for the final positions there. What a scrap then. And still carried on and looks at it. Massive swipe across the nose from Plumley, looking so desperate to defend. This is a real test of what is a very good driver. And now we look at Christian Koch, who becomes a race winner for the first time in AOR. Christian Koch wins at Interlagos. Reed will come across the line in second. Third place will go to Martinsen, his first of the season. Here as he runs himself up the hill. Robinson still ahead at the moment. It might look like a drive to the line though behind. That's going to be one that we need to see here, Fizzy, as they're going to get close. They're going to get super close. And now you can see so hard to the inside. Can't give an inch. And they are going to go side by side. It is going to be close on the line. And who is going to take it? It's Leon Robinson, I'm going to say.
Yeah, I think so. And there's another drag race to the line there. And can Kerry Nolden get through? No! I think Plumley, with an inch or less, manages to hold on to that sixth position. Unbelievable finish here at Interlagos. Two side-by-side finishes across the line. Cowie in eighth place behind them. Kessler dropped down to ninth in the end, got overtaken once again by his teammate. Imre comes across for the final top 10 position with Yannick Ninas very, very close behind as well. But wow, what can we say? What a race it's been. Absolute battles up and down the field all race long. It really was a joy to watch.
Certainly was. There is Christoph Leister then in the number 28 LM Racing machine. He'll finish 13th. There's Kager, there's Robinson. There is also Luke White there of MDAR Racing. He's secured a move to North Atlantic for next season. But there is your maiden race winner. That is Christian Koch. And he's done everything he needed to do. But Zephyr have won the battle, but Aperture, they've won the war. They are Constructors' Champions now. And well, you have to say, there are going to be some classified results straight after this. Donuts for Phil Reed, because that is a drive of the season. That is a drive of his career, you have to say, for what was the ProMaster Season 5 champion. And, well, Martinsen will join as well, hits the wall also. But this is your classified results then from Interlagos. Christian Koch in the end will slow down to a 5.3 second win over Phil Rich, who secures the fastest lap bonus there. Knut Martinsen will finish across the line in third. Leanne Robinson just edges it out by 13 thousandths of a second over Christian Takash. Masses of time. They can see Robert Plumley there with just themselves only 9 thousandths of a second there, which is a little bit closer, but still a massive gap there compared to Kerry Nolden. They can see 8th place going to Andy Cowie there, 9th to Patrick Kessler. Evan Imray then will round out your top 10. Jannik Nienhuis then will finish in 11th for Carbon Racing. What could have been for him? Bruno Domter there in 12th for the drum team. There is Christoph Leister in 13th. Steve Kager then for North Atlantic Racing in 14th. Chris Robinson 15th. Luke White secures a move to North Atlantic Racing. He's now in 16th. There is the second of the Keen Ducci cars with Torres of Talamacchia. There is Lionel Liberto and Lorenzo Wright. Senad Kocan, because he does finish 5 laps down here in 20th position, he scores half a point instead of 1 point there in 20th position. But it is his first point in AOR, or well, first half a point in AOR. But as we look then, it's one of those things for Michael Mittner. He didn't have the result that he wanted to see. There is Nigel Spears as well in his final race for North Atlantic Racing. Ty McLeod and René Oosterkamp, both Hydroforce Racing cars, then find themselves in trouble. They have both crashed out of this race. Manuel Hoyer didn't have the best day, nor did Gunnar Nienhuis, nor did Fredrik Johansson, and nor did Jamie Coldham, feigning to make the start. But we do have driver interviews for you, and we're going to join you with your first ever race winner in this series, and that is the driver of Christian Koch. Joining us in the commentary box now is your race winner, Christian Koch. Christian, debut race win here at Interlagos. You've got to be feeling excited after that.
Yeah, hi Jake. Really excited about my first win, and well, it feels good.
Yeah, no, certainly it does feel good. And well, you put yourself in the right position. You put yourself up there, willing for the fight. And once the incident started to happen between Gunnar Nienhuis and others, completely in and around the area that you were fighting for the lead, it just seemed for you that the stars aligned. You got the gap, you built it up, it was up to 11 seconds at one point, and it just seemed that nobody had the pace to catch you today.
Yeah, I had a good qualifying, that's what I lacked in the last races, and it was really okay. So tried to keep it up there, and after the start, which also was quite good because I came Senna S, I think I was P1, and after the straight I was P3, so Michael and Kerry, I think, I don't know if they touched, but Kerry had a slight wobble there, and I just came through and was P1, and then I just tried to keep the gap up. And after mid of the race, I think it was quite confident with the pace and with the gap I had, so I took out some speed to really comfortable and not making any stupid mistakes. So that was fine.
Most certainly it was fine. And for you, it's your first race win here in AOR. It's your first win in 7 starts, which is a fantastic record to have. I mean, you look at Gunnar Nienhuis, who has a 1-in-5 win ratio at the moment. You look at yourself now with a 1-in-7 and with a fantastic ratio of podium finishes as well. You have to be thinking that next season's probably going to be one that's going to be helping you.
Yeah, well, I have to say in some of the races I was really lucky and as well as in this race. So you just have to take your chances, I think, and not making any, not getting involved in any incidents. That's what I tried to do, and it was. I hope that will go on in this way, but I don't think it will be very difficult to keep up these statistics.
Yeah, very difficult to keep up those statistics, but we'll see how you do in the new season. Christian Koch, your race winner here today at the Autodromo José Carlos Pathé, Interlagos.
Thanks, Jake.
Joining us next in the commentary box then is Phil Reed. And Phil, it seems to you that qualifying didn't work out for you today. 3 off tracks, and that followed up with a spin on your qualifying lap, your final qualifying lap, which meant you had to start at the back of the grid for the second consecutive race. Just how are you feeling after a result like that from where you started?
Well, once again, qualifying is the burden, and what a way to the end of the season, another terrible qualifying. But probably my best race in this car, fighting all the way up to second, and only finishing five and a half seconds off the leader. I will take that. A few incidents for everyone else, but very happy.
Very happy indeed. Well, it just seemed that people were falling by the wayside. You look at Gunn and Ehrenhaus having an incident, Mittner involved, René Oosterkamp having his own incident, Johansson, who was up there at the time, getting tagged in an accident as well. It was just one of those things where you just had to stay calm, you had to keep it on the island, you had to make sure that you treated the track with respect as well as the car also. So for you, you have to feel that that was really all that you could hope for.
Yeah, absolutely. I had no intention of ever getting up to second during the race. You know, you can never from that starting position. But it's interesting because I'm never usually the kind of person that does the race that I did. You know, I'm always usually making a few mistakes here and there, but this was almost perfect, and it was all due to just trying to just do my race. You know, I didn't think anything of trying to get high up or things like that. I just wanted to do my own race, and it worked very well in the end.
Most certainly. And well, you look at yourself where you finished in the championship. You finished off seventh in the end of that one, with what was a title defense, which some people would say wasn't the most convincing in the end of it. Failed to get a race win, which is meaning that you're only the first driver not to do that. But for you, it's all about gearing up to the next season. You're seeing the new quick guys who are coming in, who are looking to get there. Your life's going to be a little bit more difficult. Do you think you can find more pace in the car and more consistency?
Well, consistency is something that I was hoping to improve on this season. I don't think I quite got there. I think the last three or four races were much better in terms of my pace. But yeah, hopefully next season that's something that I can improve on. I will say, on the title defence, I personally believe that this is probably one of the strongest grids we've had, maybe even the strongest and competitive grid that we have. So I don't feel too bad about not getting a win in it, really. You know, it went pretty well. It didn't go too well for us, really, but I mean, the end of the season strongly, I think that's all that matters. Momentum into the next season, and we'll see how it goes from there.
Momentum needed indeed. Phil Reed, second place finish today for what is Aperture Motorsport. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Joining us in the commentary box now is the team owner for Force Fizzy. It's also everyone's favourite commentator, it's Fizzy. And Fizzy, it just seems to me that your driver Martinsen there, he qualified okay. He finished on the podium, which is always great to see. First podium of the season. It's a shame it does come at the end. So do you think he's going to take this as a learning curve moving on into the next season?
Yeah, I mean, obviously very pleased with how we performed today. He did have a cheeky listen into the team radio after Derry crossed the line, and he was certainly very pleased. You know, obviously he started quite far down in qualifying, in 10th, so you know, had a lot of work to do. I still think he was pretty pleased with that, considering it was only 4/10 off pole and how close the qualifying was in general. But then, yeah, obviously did take advantage of several of the guys in front of him having incidents at various stages of the race, which definitely helped a lot. I know he did make an actual pass on Patrick Kessler at some point. He seemed to be kind of glued to him for a while recently. And yeah, I mean, he didn't really make any mistakes as far as I noticed anyway. And certainly a cracking battle in the final few laps with his teammate for next season, Leanne Robinson.
Yeah, I was going to talk about that one, Fizzy, because you look at Leanne Robinson, of course, they were part of the same outlet at AOR Red and AOR Blue. And now you're going to see Leanne Robinson come back into Force for Fizzy. Was it a case of both Robinson and Martinsen just hoping that they wouldn't take each other out and then having animosity, you could say, heading towards the new season? Because you have to admit, it was a little bit worrying just sitting on the pit wall.
Yeah, it definitely was. I mean, or sitting in the country box as I was. but it was certainly many twitchy moments on my foot when I was watching that. And yeah, it certainly would have been not at all the ideal situation if they had gone in after an incident here that took away the chance of a podium for both of them. So, but you know, based on that, I feel like, you know, at least I can be pretty confident that I have made a solid choice on drivers for next season in terms of the Force Fisi team. I mean, Robinson, just the fact that he... I think Martinsen will be very pleased with him as well, because he really fought off to catch a lot in the final few laps, which really gave Martinsen the chance to get that tiny gap that he needed to hold on to that podium in the end, even though the catch behind, arguably, you know, based on season form, had the pace to pass them, but Robinson just managed to keep him behind somehow. And yeah, I mean, I think for this season, it's... You have to say it didn't quite work out with Coldham, who scored 5 points all season. A lot of DNFs for him. Certainly next season with Robinson, I've got higher hopes that we can challenge a bit higher in the team championship.
Yes, most certainly. And well, for Martinsen in the end, Interlagos has always been a circuit where he's performed quite well. I mean, who can remember season 5 and exactly the fantastic battles he had with both Michael Mittner and René Osterkamp in the fight for what was second place at the time. So, was it just the case of knowing that Martinsen really gelled around a circuit like Interlagos and that he could pull off the result if he needed to?
Yeah, I mean, I know that it is one of his favourite tracks. Even though he was struggling a little bit in practice, but for the race he managed to pull it together well. And he's been struggling for some races this season in terms of getting comfortable with the new car and all that. But certainly now he can go into the next season with a bit more confidence, which is a good positive at least.
Yes, most certainly there. There you can see Fizzy in the commentary box with us then. Team owner for what is Force Fizzy Racing right now. Thank you for joining us. Jean-Francois Gaudin then is your driver's champion then. From Interlagos, he finishes on a total of 246 points and he beats Christian Takash into second place in the driver's championship. There you can see Kerry Nolden, not the season he would have wanted, but he will be pleased in the fact that he still finished third, but he has a lot to do in terms of being up at the top of the caliber next season. Gunnar Nienhaus was arguably one of the most unluckiest drivers in the league this season. He's gone and finished fourth with Michael Mittner fifth and René Osterkamp sixth. Both of those drivers, they were up second and third with two races to go. Two DNFs have really cost them. Phil Reed will finish then in seventh. Andy Cowie eighth. Christian Koch, though, despite coming in four races late, he still scores 150 points. So could have really challenged for the title if he started off correctly. Of course, he's only raced seven races this season. With Lee N. Robinson there rounding out the top 10 of your driver standings. Martinsen there in 11th. Plumlee still had to use a drop week there, but he's scored 122 very solid points over 12 weeks there. You can see also Patrick Kessler finding great form towards the end. Likes of Imre had a great season. Once again, another top 15 for him. Likes of Jannik Nienhaus will look to try and get themselves a good season. Leist will probably be looking for a little bit more. Of course, he's trying to get used to the car. Lionel Liberto, another good season for him inside the top 20 as well for Team Oneline. So there you can see the likes of Lorenzo Reich looking for a little bit more. Santalamacchia, solid season by his respects. Alexander Van Rompuy was there after his one race result. And there you can see also Ty McLeod. Oh, he needs a lot better results than that, knowing the pace that we've seen of him. Tom Van Heumann there in 29th. And looking back then onto what is your final page as well. It just seems to me that you got 39 drivers who have participated this season. The likes of Erke Lindstrom, the last we'll see of Jamie Colden for a little bit. Richard Grimley, of course, another driver who's going to be leaving just for the time being, and there you can see the likes of Kokan, Belafonte, Ronald Gibbons, Ben Scott, and James Goodall as well. But there is more than just a driver's standings. There is also a team standings as well. And well, Aperture Motorsport take the team standings in the end by a full 8 points in just for the end of it there. There you are, 10 points clear of LM Rennsport as Zephyr Racing. Garvin Racing there in fourth, Hydro Force in fifth, there is Red Devolution in sixth there. Team Tortoise there, fantastic results for them. They get themselves seventh position overall ahead of Robinson Racing. LM Racing ninth with Kinducci rounding out the top 10 then for the constructors. And well, what has to be said is there is the second page, Force Fizzy. Pretty much a one-man team being carried there by Martinsen. And looking further down, Rich Racing could do a bit more. One line, very solid there for the 21 teams. It's Kart Squad there in 20th there. And also Team DNA. SRG as well. But Fizzy, we do have to talk about a brand new season then, because we've just finished these 12, but I do believe you have the brand new schedule being sought out for you.
Indeed, and it's looking like it's going to be another very interesting season. I mean, I'm lost for words kind of for how this season has been. It's been so much action we've witnessed throughout this 12 races this time around. You know, and the team championship and the driver's championship both being very close throughout. So I really have no idea what to expect for next season, and plus some new strong drivers coming in as well. Anything could happen in season 2. I'm very much looking forward to it.
Up on your screen right now is your season 2 schedule for your AOR Formula Renault 2.0 Championship. And well, we're going to start things off again at Spa-Francorchamps. Well, there's quite a few things that are going to be surprising here. Tracks that we haven't visited in a long time. Tracks we haven't actually visited before. But there are two tracks that stand out here, which we haven't been to before here, Fizzy. One is round 9. We're heading to Alton Park for the very first time. And the other, round 7. Autodroma Internazionale Enzo Edina Ferrari, otherwise known as Imola.
Yeah, for the first time, of course, on this game, and the first time anyone will be driving in this car, so that should be super interesting. Imola, such an historic track, and I think it's one that's going to suit this car as well. And Alton Park, a very tight and twisty track, could be a pretty tricky one to get through as well, so always good to see new tracks in the schedule, certainly.
Most certainly it will be, but it was the road to Interlagos. It will now be the road to the Nürburgring. That has been Fizzy. I've been Jake Sparey. That was a fantastic race. Zephyr won the battle. Aperture win the war. Koch will have his day in the sun as a driver's winner here at Interlagos. But what has to be said is this has been a fantastic season, and your new champion is Jean-Francois Gaudin. Good night.